My name is Jerry Kroth. I'm a professor in California. And if you've seen some of my videos, they tend to be relatively radical, but they're substantive and they're documented. But it's not mainstream stuff that you see on Face the Nation and Meet the Press. So you're going to be treated to a very, very different view of homelessness today. So let's begin taking a look at Los Angeles.
Los Angeles is now coming together to confront the greatest moral and humanitarian crisis of our time. Let me be clear once again, we are here to end homelessness.
5 years after Los Angeles voters approved tax increases to raise $1.5 billion to address the region's homelessness problem, there are more people living and dying on the streets than ever before. Many of these men and women are both...
They passed a $1 billion budget to build 10,000 units, and after 4 years, they built 1,000. The reason is that people don't want homeless communities or low-rent housing for homeless people in their cities. They don't want them there. There's a lot of resistance. So the bureaucracy prevented any real solution. Now, when I talk about a radical vision, I mean something you've never heard of. We are going to solve homelessness in this country in 2 years, okay? It is possible with a radical different attitude. I'm not asking you for money or to donate your time or any of that sort of thing. We are starting with a new idea of the use of presidential emergency powers. Do you remember that Trump, during COVID, said, we're going to have 500,000 new ventilators, and he used what is called the Defense Production Act to order General Motors to make 500,000 ventilators. The president has emergency authority to cut through all sorts of regulations and inhibitions and get things done. Okay? So I want to approach this that way. And let's take a look at a few facts, okay? And this is part of the rationale for that. What do you think the average life expectancy is for a homeless person in the United States? Your life expectancy is 78.79. Their life expectancy is 50 years, okay? They die 28 years earlier than we do, okay? This is a national public health emergency, like COVID. It needs to be approached with presidential emergency powers. So when we get started here, we're going to take a look at a few facts, get our homework done. What percentage of homeless people are African American? Answer, 39%. That's three times the national average of African Americans in this country. What percentage of homeless people are elderly? 30%. Okay? So before we get started on how we're going to solve this problem, and I promise you, by the end of this video, you're going to say, my God, we really could do this. Okay? But I want you to meet a few homeless people. I want to stay close to our data. So here are a few homeless people we're interviewing. Not me, but that I've got from various film clips.
Corey.
Yes.
We're here in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
You're homeless.
Yes, I am.
Tell me about it.
I've been homeless ever since 17 in different states. In LA, I've only been homeless here for 4.5 months, which is around the same time I've been in the shelter as well with my 8-month-old. But I will no longer be there by the 28th. Of March, which is this month. Honestly, I am scared because I haven't even looked for any type of stable housing, which they say they were gonna help me with that, but haven't at all.
First off, you are disabled and can't work.
No, I can't work because I was born with Asperger's. I've been diagnosed since 3, and that has gave me Social Security. I get $795 a month, and that would not cover anything.
Sandy, we're here in Berkeley, California. You're sleep in your car, but it's against the law, so you sleep on the sidewalk.
Yeah, I sleep on the sidewalk in a sleeping bag, and I'm trying to, I don't use drugs, I don't use alcohol, I don't really do anything wrong. I'm just old, and it's hard to find work at my age. And so if anybody out there wants to hire me, I am very employable, and anything to get off the streets, it's a miserable existence. I'm not completely crazy yet, but I'm getting there.
Wow.
From sleeping, you know, just having to live this lifestyle.
What are the police don't make it easy on you?
Oh, no. I've got a warrant right now for sleeping outside. Basically, it's a trespassing warrant. I was trying to get away from people who were up all night because of various reasons, drugs or whatever. But, you know, But I have to get away from them, and so some nights you literally have to hide. It's not safe for women, especially older women.
Yeah,
city.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and so this was the car you had.
Right, it's a Pontiac, 2005 Pontiac Grand Am. It's a six-cylinder and four-door, and I really did have to do some changing to make it work.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and so far, so it's only been a month, about
right,
a month.
About a month.
And it's a little too early to know, but so far so good.
So far so good. I'm determined I can do it for a few years in this. I'd like to upgrade to a van and become a van camper, but in the meantime, this is the way I have to live. And
okay, well, let's a couple questions that I know everyone's going to ask. When you live in a car, you support yourself with a Social Security check.
Yeah.
And how do you go to the bathroom?
Well, it's hard in a car, so you have to really, have to work it out. I have two things. I have a pee bucket, basically, which I do not line.
Monica.
Yes.
You're homeless.
Yes, I am.
You're living in this RV.
Yes.
And you lost your legs 3 months ago.
Yes, I did.
Tell me about it.
Well, it all began when it was really cold, and it was like 30-something degrees, and I didn't have enough blankets to cover myself, or, you know, I was living in a tent outside, and my feet started getting purple, and I kind of got worried. I said, oh, my God, you know, because I've never had my feet that color. So I let it go, you know, I let it pass by maybe a week or two. But then my friend goes, no, you have to go to the hospital. You know, you look like something's wrong with you. So I did. I went to the hospital, and that's when they told me that I had to go to surgery. And then, like, a week later is when they took me to emergency, and I got my legs amputated. And, yeah.
What is heartbreaking,
yeah,
is they let you go without any support.
Exactly. I don't know, I'm not sure what kind of anesthesia they put on you. And I went to sleep, and when I woke up, I had no legs. And it was simple as that. And I don't think they did it the right way. They should have told me at least, you know what, we're gonna take out your legs or something. I think you're supposed to be told, right?
Hi. My name is Ronald Davis. I've been on the street for about a year and a half now. Well, I come from the suburbs. Life, you know, which is rough. And, I mean, I didn't sleep in the Lower Wacker. I didn't sleep on the bridges. I didn't sleep in the little cardboard boxes and stuff, you know, just surviving, especially in the wintertime is the hardest time. And, like, I go to a few lot of applications for a job and stuff. They look at me, you know, I'm not looking presentable. And then they, well, we'll call you, leave a number. But how can I leave a number when I don't have a phone? So it's just a struggle out here, you know. I just, you know, from day to day, people, I come out here and panhandle with my cup right here at the Metro train station. People come off, bringing me sandwiches and stuff like this here. It's really humiliating to be shaking a cup 24 hours a day and people just look at you like you're some kind of little bum, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I have had people to walk past me and say, get a job, bum. And I said, wait a minute, I'm not a bum, I'm a human being. And it's hard. But after the end of the day, when people go home and everybody get on the metro train, and then I just feel so bad that I can't be going home. You know, I'm sorry.
Now, I want to also show you people at the extremes. Those are more typical people, but there are people at this extreme and at the other. So two more, and then we'll get started.
You can drive a rocket plane with a motorcycle engine. It's all real cheap to do.
I hear things. The buses laugh at me.
Now, at the other extreme, this is a faculty member at San Jose State University. She's an adjunct lecturer, has a master's degree, I guess, has $145,000 in student debt. I think she teaches English literature, no tenure. And getting an apartment in San Jose, California is not easy. It's extremely expensive. So she teaches and she lives in her car. Okay? She lives in the faculty parking lot and she corrects papers in her car, because her salary is not enough for her to live. Okay, now with that introduction, let's get started solving America's homeless problem in 2 years. I guarantee you, you will say at the end of this, my God, we could do this. All right, so let's start with the most difficult problem first, which is, well, first, there are 580,000 homeless people in this country, and 26 or 25% of them are mentally ill. That's 145,000 people who are seriously mentally, chronically mentally ill. How are we going to solve this problem? Well, we're going to declare a presidential emergency, a public health emergency, and we're going to cut through all of the regulations and get this job done. In Los Angeles, there have been rat-borne, flea-borne diseases like typhus that are breaking out. Medieval diseases are breaking out amongst the homeless community. In Boston, a human leptospirosis disease, a rat-borne disease, has appeared. So we are declaring a public health emergency here and proceeding now to deal with the first major problem, mental illness.
On January 3rd, 1999, a man named Andrew Goldstein wandered onto this New York City subway platform and shoved a stranger named Kendra Webdale into the path of an oncoming train. With the story making national news, reporters dug into Goldstein's past and found that he had been diagnosed with schizophrenia and had a history of violent episodes. He had been in and out of psychiatric facilities, but his caretakers repeatedly released him back into the streets against their better judgment because of a shortage of available beds. The murder of Kendra Webdale brought attention to our inability to provide adequate treatment to Americans with severe mental health problems, which 20 years later is still ongoing. Prisons and jails are filled with inmates exhibiting symptoms of mental illness and in need of treatment. Many of the homeless people crowding the streets of cities like Los Angeles, San Francisco, and New York are mentally ill and in need of care. And violent episodes like the murder of Kendra Webdale have brought renewed calls to bring back one of America's most controversial institutions, the mental hospital.
Some psychiatrists and bioethicists have proposed bring back the psychiatric hospital.
You know, in the old days, we had mental institutions, and you could nab somebody like this because, you know, they did. They knew something was off.
The parents of mentally ill patients are among the most vocal advocates.
They shut down all the hospitals because, oh, we have all these medicines now, and everybody can be in recovery. Well, the unfortunate fact is not everybody recovers. So where do they go?
Where do they go? All right, so what is our solution? Here we go. There have been studies done that a person out there on the street who's chronically mentally ill, severely mentally ill, ends up in emergency rooms 5, 10, 20 times a year. And the cost to the state is about $40,000 per patient for just this temporary mental care. This is from Representative Tim Murphy, a child psychologist. The mentally ill have nowhere to go and often land hard in emergency rooms, county jails, and city streets. We have replaced the hospital bed with the jail cell, the homeless shelter, and the coffin. How is that compassion? So, what does it cost to put a homeless, mentally ill person in a place where they have shelter and custodial care? Well, it's about $3,000 a month. Some say $5,000 a month. Okay, well, let's do it. Each mentally ill person in this country will get a treatment voucher for $60,000. That will open a lot of doors. How much is that going to cost? Well, it's going to cost $8.7 billion to take every seriously mentally ill patient and put them in a hospital where they are cared for. Well, do we have enough hospital beds? There are 35,000 beds and about 603 psychiatric hospitals, some public, some private, some profit. But we need at least 145,000 beds. Where are we going to put these people? Well, there are board and care homes, or called assisted living homes, where mentally ill people sometimes are housed. And many of these are going out of business because they run out of money. But they house close to 1 million people. So there's another set of beds there, because now we have a person who has a $60,000 treatment voucher. And they knock on your door and you say, oh, come right in. We need you. All right, so there are facilities. People don't get treated because they don't have the money, the insurance, the Medicare, whatever. Now they do. Now, there are old psychiatric hospitals like these that have been closed. Why are hospitals closing? Articles appear. In 2020, 21 hospitals closed. In 2019, 47 hospitals closed. Hospitals have been turned into condominiums in New York. This is a guy, Robert Kaplan, psychiatrist, who writes in Psychology Today, don't close more state hospitals. We need to house these people. We need to get them off the street. They're turning hospitals into condos. So we're going to try and find 20,000 more beds, okay? And how are we going to do that? Well, we're going to try to bring 10,000 beds from old hospitals that have closed and try to rehabilitate them and reopen them, okay? And then we're going to also think about building a few new psychiatric hospitals with 10,000 beds. Stay with me. This hospital closed. It closed because it had 476 patients, but they needed $3 million a month and they didn't have the money, so they closed. Well, what is that? That's $72,000 per patient. They could have, for $72,000 per patient, we could have kept that hospital open. Let's use that as our calculating formula to rehabilitate or reconstruct. If we spent $72,000 per bed in an old hospital, could we get 10,000 beds? And how much would that cost? That would cost $720 million, Mr. President. All right, how about new hospital beds? Well, new hospital beds in new hospitals cost $500,000 per bed. And we're going to have to build psychiatric hospitals, about 25. In 2 years? It takes 3 to 6 years to build a hospital. How are we going to do it in 2 years? Because this is a presidential emergency. Just like we got 500,000 ventilators, we're going to do this. That's going to cost $5.7 billion. Look at that picture. That's China. They built a hospital for 1,000 people in 10 days. We're going to do the same in 2 years. 25 such hospitals to create 10,000 new beds, 10,000 old beds. Total cost? $5.72 billion. Don't be worried about the money. You're going to be surprised at the end of this. Here's a hospital in Houston. Took them 2 years to build it. Okay, 264 beds. They did it in 2.5 years. It's possible to do. And under presidential emergency authority, we get cracking immediately. Now watch this carefully. This is your first moment of somewhat astonishment. How much does it cost? 145,000 seriously, chronically, mentally ill people. These people don't get better. They are intractable. They need custodial care. $60,000 each, $8.7 billion. Construction of new psychiatric hospitals in 2 years is $5.7 billion. Resurrection of old hospitals with 10,000 beds, $720 million. Well, how much is that going to cost? For the first year, it's going to cost $15.12 billion. Well, what about the second year? Well, in the second year, it will cost a little less, and 9.4. Okay, how much is it going to cost? There it is. $24 billion would take every homeless, mentally ill patient off the streets, out of tents, and into custodial care. That's what it would cost. Now, I would like to tell, I have three digressions during this talk, and one of them is starting now. It's called my Bernie Sanders moment. Okay? So, we're going to interrupt this talk with a few little digressions. This one starts in Sweden. I was invited to give a talk in Sweden at a university, Lund University, very famous and pretty, except it was snowing and freezing cold. And I go and I gave a talk in the psych department in English, and I was there for 1 day, and I checked into a hotel. I got a hotel on Expedia. It was $105. And I'm checking out of my hotel, and the lady said, it's $195, sir. I said, no, it's $105. She said, no, taxes. I said, $90 in taxes? What's going on? $195? And she said, well, you know, this is Sweden, sir. I said, what do you mean? Well, do you see any homeless people around here? And I said, no. Do you know that everybody has free medical care? Well, and you know, if you go, you don't have student loan debt in this country. If you're qualified, you get free education at a university level. Wow. And I stood there in front of her desk saying, you know what? If we had free medical care, free college, and no homelessness, I'd pay those taxes. That was my Bernie Sanders moment, and that influences this talk. Now, I wanted, before telling you this story, I wanted to do some fact-checking on myself. So I did, and indeed, higher education in Sweden is indeed free. Their medical system is almost free. You have to pay like $10 copay when you see a doctor, and you might have to pay as much as $230 a year for drugs. That's it. But it's otherwise free, and it's automatic, and it's universal. And they do have a few thousand people who are homeless, not many. Okay, so let's go to our next problem. That was our first digression. Now, this one is a toughie. This is called drug addiction. 26% of homeless people, of those 580,000 people, are drug addicts. All right? That's 150,000 people. How are we going to get them treated, get them off the street? One question is, are you a drug addict because you're homeless? Or are you homeless because you're a drug addict? There's a discussion in the homeless theories. Well, a person who becomes homeless medicates themselves on the street because it's a very painful existence, and they can turn into a drug addict, or a drug addict gets kicked out of this place, kicked out of that place, and ends up on the street. Well, I was astonished by this statistic. There are more drug addicts in San Francisco than high school students. Holy. Well, we're going to try and figure out how are we going to solve this problem. With the attitude, with presidential emergency powers, everything is possible. So in Sweden, they have a thing called compulsory care. You don't have a choice in the matter. You either go to prison for illegal drug possession, or you're required to go through drug rehabilitation. It's compulsory. So you have to go to rehab, whether you like it or not, in Sweden. Let's try that out, all right? So residential drug treatment, off the street into a place, 30 days for detox, or 60 days for detox, or 90 days for detox, which means we're getting medicines like methadone, naloxone, and other things, counseling. That's very costly. Residential drug treatment costs between $2,000 to $20,000 for 30 days and at least twice that for 90 days, so about $40,000. Listen to this lady talk about the fact that 30 days and 60 days doesn't work as well as 90.
So the difference between a 30-day program and a 90-day program is that in a 90-day program, we can really concentrate on getting you well. We can not only just try to get you ready to hear and collect the tools for your recovery, and we really watch these people come in here and transform their lives and transform their bodies and their health. And they usually report that they're amazed too, that they feel so well when they come in as compared to where they were.
Now, I thought, I'm going to call this agency. And I called them and I said, well, let's pretend I had no Medicare, no Medi-Cal, no insurance at all. What would it cost me to come for 90 days of residential drug treatment? And she said, $70,000. Okay. So let's use that number, $70,000, because 90 days is effective. 30 and 60 in terms of the literature is not that great. Now, how much is that going to cost? 150,000 addicts given 90-day residential rehab? $10 billion. Okay, stay with me. Can the American system handle 150,000 addicts? Well, there are 14,500 drug rehabilitation centers in the United States. And we're not sending them all at once. 40,000 for 3 months, another 40,000 for 3 months, another 40,000 for 3 months. By the end of the first year, they've all gone to a 90-day drug rehab. This is the stuff that movie stars and celebrities get, okay? Would they take these people? I mean, these are people right off the street. This is not Britney Spears or some famous person. These are people off the street. Well, they're showing up at the door saying, I have a $70,000 treatment voucher. Are you sure you can't open those doors? Now, they go for their 90 days, but then what happens?
Change themselves because they don't have a plan of action. They don't have any kind of support system. Wherever they're going back to, they're going right back to that same lifestyle. Point of treatment is that you're learning all kinds of different ways of staying sober. You're getting the tools basically to move on and live a life where you stay sober, where you are sober and you remain sober.
Okay, so we can't send them back out on the street after their 90 days. They need to have shelter. So let's make a $1,250 rental voucher for 9 months. That's $14,000 in rental vouchers. Go get yourself a room in a motel, a room in a rooming house, or an apartment. Plus $50 a week food allowance for those 9 months that follow your treatment. Total cost with all of that post-rehab 9 months, $1.95 billion. Okay, watch now. Summary, $70,000 for a 90-day residential drug rehab program for 150,000 American addicts, $10 billion. Post-hospitalization support, $1.9 billion. Total cost, $12 billion. But even with 90 days, there is relapse. There is a relapse rate of 17%. Even if you've gone for 90 days of drug rehab. So we have to do it again. for those 17%, almost one in five relapse. Okay, how much will that cost? $2 billion more, please. Well, what's the total cost to rehabilitate all of America's homeless drug addicts? You're not going to believe this. Maybe you think that's a lot. $15.1 billion. That's a realistic number. Okay? So we can do it. This is before, this is after. 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 It's all possible to do. All we need is the authority to proceed and to stop this problem. Okay, are you ready for your second digression? All right, so this is a federal emergency program like COVID. It's not replacing or substituting for anything. We have all sorts of things for homeless people. We have food stamps. We have the Health and Human Services Department, the Housing and Urban Development Department, Social Security. All those things are still there, standing. They're still operating. We're running this program with their cooperation, okay? You could still get food stamps up to $283 a month. You're not disqualified from that because you're in this program. They still will get Medicare and Medicaid and Section 8 housing and Social Security disability. All of those things are still available to all of these people. This program we are talking about is an emergency program that is on top of everything else, and there is no bureaucracy allowed. Okay? This is just going to get done using presidential emergency powers. General Motors, make those ventilators. Build those psychiatric hospitals. Okay? Okay, that was your second digression. Let's move on. Who's left? Well, we did 145,000 mentally ill people. And we talked about 150,000 addicts. Now, the rest of the problems are much easier, but there are still 260,000 people living outside who are not drug addicts and not mentally ill, who are poor, who are down on their luck, who are unemployed, who are seniors, who don't have enough money to, and that professor, and disabled people. What are we going to do for those 260,000 people? Well, we're going to do four things, things that really haven't been done, or they have, but not effectively. We're going to put them in rental housing, or we're going to create homeless gated communities, or we're going to create car parking communities, or we're going to create recreational vehicle parking communities, okay, for 65,000 and 65,000 and 65,000 and another 65,000, making a grand total of 260,000 poor people who are going to be helped and get out of tents and out of the cold and out of the snow and out of the rain. So let's talk about rental housing first, okay? The average rental in the United States for an apartment is $1,216 a month. Now, that's not going to get you anything in San Diego or Los Angeles or Sacramento or San Jose or San Francisco or Hawaii or New York City, okay? It's not going to get you much of anything. But we're going to give a rental voucher to 65,000 people of $1,216 a month for a year, plus $75 a week for food allowance, utilities, furnishing, and all of that. That's going to cost $1.2 billion. Okay? Now, that may not go anywhere in San Diego, but what about Decatur, Illinois, or Knoxville, Tennessee, or San Antonio, Texas, or Colorado Springs? It might work there. After all, that's an average. So that's a median figure, maybe. Okay? So 50% of those apartments cost less than that in the United States.
So, I'm gonna be honest with you. This isn't really my house. This is your house.
You gotta be kidding me, right?
No. This is not my house, this is yours. Come on.
You have to be kidding me, right?
Not at all.
Come on, big bro. You got to be kidding me.
We got this for you.
Oh my God! Oh my God, big brother! No! You go! Oh my God! Oh my God! No! Yeah. My God! Oh. Man. Oh, this is a joke.
No joke at all.
So
we're going to do that. They raised the money for 1 year of rent for him. And that's what we're going to do for 65,000 people. That's our first 65,000 people. The second thing we're going to do is to create homeless gated communities. Here's one. Here's another. They look nice. People don't want them in their neighborhood. They don't want homeless people wandering around. Mentally ill people, not near our schools, not near our children. Thank you very much. Lots of resistance. I spoke to that guy. He's an architect. $20,000 for that unit. Okay.
How can someone making $10,000 in Detroit become a homeowner?
If you've never had the opportunity to own a home, this is a once-in-a-lifetime dream-come-true opportunity.
So there are lots of experiments. San Francisco created shelters like this. Pretty nice, better than a tent, no toilet. Cost $15,000 a pop, but when you add in restrooms and landscaping and fencing and security and other things, it's $30,000 a unit, and San Francisco took great pride in the fact that for $30,000 a unit, they served 70 people, but there are 8,000 homeless people living in tents, defecating on the streets of San Francisco. So that is really a drop in the bucket. So I was researching these. This is an impressive experiment in Eugene, Oregon. Watch carefully.
I'm Dan Bryant. I am a pastor of First Christian Church in downtown Eugene. This project actually began with another facility, Opportunity Village Eugene, that's a transitional housing program where we were just trying to get people off the street to give them the most basic shelter, just sleeping cabins, a place to be, a place that was secure and safe to help them get their life back together so that they could move into permanent housing. And we discovered after about our first year that we were having great difficulty assisting people in moving out, that they were not able to find any place that they could afford because rents in our community are simply too high. So we decided we needed to build our own style of affordable housing using the concepts we developed at Opportunity Village, a self-managed community of tiny homes ranging from 160 to 280 square feet. A place for a single person or a couple or maybe a parent and child, but small households of one or two people, where they could afford to live and have really a nice quality built home, and most importantly, where they could afford to pay their own way. So this is designed so that the individuals who live here are actually paying for all of the operation costs, the long-term maintenance of the facility, the staffing, and so forth. The utilities, all of that's covered in their payments of $250 to $350 a month, depending on the size of their unit, so that they have the pride of being able to pay their own way.
I have Social Security benefits and a little bit of tiny retirement, and I'll pay $375 a month, and that will be my parking and my rent, my electricity, and my Wi-Fi for my computer. So it's very affordable now, you know, $375 out of the $900 I get, you know, that still leaves me enough to pay my car insurance and, you know, my telephone and my medications and my doctors and things. So I can do just fine on that.
I love this house because, like, it gives me a sense of security and, like, a space that's my own.
This is 288 square feet, and I don't need any more. I have a little front room. I have my own bedroom, a bathroom. Yes, the square footage is just fine.
A permanent place to live. I honestly thought I was going to be in my car forever, and that was not a prospect that I really looked forward to after having spent my whole life working and being a productive member of society and contributing to this great country. I found myself being marginalized and treated as a second-class citizen, given nothing but hassles because I couldn't afford to pay rent. I had an income, just wasn't enough. And this I can afford, this I can live in, and I'm so thankful for having this place to live in. And had 7.5 months of electricity, warmth, companionship with all the other people in the village. It has been just a godsend. I can't begin to express just how much it means to me to finally know that I will be safe for the rest of my life. I will have a place that will make sure I am taken care of, that I have got a roof over my head and a way to cook and eat and clean and be still thought of as having value to this society.
We're so fortunate to be able to be picked to come here in this 2E village, and we need more of them.
So during this talk, I have a lot of film clips, and I never know whether YouTube is going to say copyright infringement. In a university, I would be able to do this using fair use. That is not always true with YouTube. So there may be moments when things get interrupted, but I hope you'll have the patience to watch this all the way through, because it's getting, it's quite phenomenal what's happening here. Now, they have computer rooms, they have, in this village, they have meeting rooms, they make their own rules, they admit people, they have to fill out applications. But one guy in Los Angeles said, oh, we have the biggest homeless gated community, 178 units. Well, that's not true. I found one in Austin, Texas, that was, now, they take the village and they move it out of town. People don't want those people in town. That was Los Angeles's problem. So here they got a 500-acre site out of town. It's a religious organization called Loaves and Fishes. They made a homeless community for 1,400 people.
Provides affordable permanent housing along with a supportive community for men and women who are transitioning out of chronic homelessness. Everything you see around the village is designed to foster relationships. One of the first things you see when entering the village is the neighborhood's large outdoor movie screen and amphitheater. The space can hold about 400 guests and provides the perfect setting for regular movie nights or other special events hosted at the village. Just past the amphitheater and community inn is an on-site Capital Metro bus stop. With direct access to mass transportation, neighbors have an easier time getting around to other parts of the city as needed. Across the street from the bus stop is the Topfer Family Health Resource Center. This on-site clinic, managed by MLF Partners, is the primary spot in the village where neighbors have access to integrated physical and mental health care services. Because of the clinic, men and women living in Community First Village can get many of their health care needs addressed on-site. Right next door to the clinic is the community market, a small convenience store of sorts. The market makes it possible for neighbors to purchase small grocery items and other basic needs, and a wood shop where carpentry skills are put to use. It even includes a car care operation, which is located just past the market in the village's very active maintenance building. Need an oil change or a car wash? Community First Car Care provides our neighbors who have a passion for servicing cars an opportunity to be of service to you. Since none of the tiny homes has plumbing or full kitchens, this area of the village is connected to 5 outdoor kitchens. Residents have access to the kitchens anytime they want, providing them a spot where they can make great meals together and connect with other neighbors, human to human, heart to heart,
through the fellowship of food. Neighbors in Tiny Town also have access to 5 nearby laundry, restroom, shower facilities. These buildings provide private showers and restrooms, along with mini laundromats where residents can do their laundry however often they please.
So I was certainly like the barbershop, the auto repair, small grocery, but most importantly, the fact that it connected with a bus. So it allowed a person in this village to go to the city and have a job and come back to their gated community. So there's also the Elon Musk boxable house, which can be delivered to a site and assembled in a few hours.
To unpack and set up. So that can be a crane or a telehandler. However, we spent a lot of time trying to eliminate this heavy equipment because, of course, it adds cost. And the goal here...
That's what it looks like once it's assembled. It comes with a bedroom, a kitchen, a living room. It's $50,000. Now, of course, you have to hook up electricity and septic, so there are other costs. So what exactly are the costs to build a gated homeless community? Well, the San Francisco experiment was $30,000 a unit, but they only built 70. The Portland community, they bought the land, so it comes to $85,000 a unit. But it's in a location where neighbors are not going to clamor and protest and get upset that there are homeless people living there. The Austin experiment, I couldn't find the cost. I had to look at their financial statements. It looks like it's about $85,000 a unit with all of the infrastructure put in. So, and the boxable house, of course, is $50,000. So let's take a look at what it would cost to create 130 homeless gated communities in the United States with 500 units each that would take care of 65,000 people. What would that cost? Now, these communities are going to be located a bit outside. They need to be away from all of the wrath of the neighbors. But if they have bus connections to the city, that can be very helpful. So using that rationale, at $80,000 a unit with bus connections and shop, an internet area, community area, laundromats, it would cost $5.2 billion. And the second year, assuming that 15% of them found housing and found jobs and left the program, well, we'd still have to maintain those units. Total cost for a second year, $1.6 billion. Altogether, 1 and 2 years, $6.8 billion. I'm not going to throw a lot of these numbers at you willy-nilly. I am going to throw a lot of numbers at you, but there's a very important point to be made here. So please have your patience with this. We said we are going to do 4 things. Put these people who are not mentally ill or drug addicts, 260,000 of them, put them in rental housing or put them in great gated homeless communities or create car parking communities. Let's take a look at this third option. There are people who sleep in their cars and they get rousted. Listen to what's going on in San Diego City Council about people sleeping in their cars.
And this situation with living in the vans is a problem.
My car keeps me safe. My car protects me from having to be on the streets.
You are creating a massive free-for-all that is being taken advantage of by people who are not homeless by circumstance.
If you support this ban, stop saying you care about the homeless.
The city council voted Tuesday to prohibit people from living in their cars from 9 p.m. to 6 a.m. in San Diego.
And that passed.
So it passed, and now you can't sleep in your car. And if you do, you get a ticket. Well, where does a homeless person go if that's their last refuge? This guy got 104 parking tickets, and he had a very kind judge. But here's what the judge said, because he was sleeping in his car and he had no place to go. No.
How many parking tickets do you think you've had?
I said, oh gosh, I don't know, probably about 80.
80?
Yeah.
He thinks he had 80 parking tickets then.
It's probably more than that. I'm just
he had 101.
Is it? Yeah, that was close. 101.
Okay. These are overnight parking tickets. Get yourself a parking spot.
So he said, get yourself a parking spot. These are overnight parking violations. Yeah, they are, because you're not allowed to sleep in your car. Well, the judge forgave him and was a very nice guy. But the issue is doesn't go away.
Safe parking is a critical investment as it targets those just entering homelessness or those that are homeless for the very first time. Each night, there is a neighborhood here created. Children are doing their homework. They're playing. Families are taking their dog for a walk.
Today, we're taking another important step in helping people escape homelessness by expanding a terrific safe parking program. But our current laws don't allow them to stay parked in one place while they sleep. And moving from one location at night makes their days harder and makes it more difficult for them to get out of the cycle of homelessness. And so today we are making it a little bit easier for them by announcing the expansion of this safe parking program.
These are children doing homework in their car, mothers trying to put their kids to bed, and fathers applying to become a police officer.
You know, you think of homeless, and you think of 17th Street, you think of downtown, you think of East Village. Those are chronically ill homeless people. Then you have people that really don't want to be here. This is not a long-term program for us. This is-
so here is a community that has been created to help people who are living out of their cars. Take a look at this.
In Southern California, the sun rises over San Diego Bay. Next to a parkway, in this parking lot, 54-year-old Maria begins her day.
Straighten my bed.
This car is her home.
This is every day. This routine about stretching my bed.
Maria no longer has a place to live. She's been sleeping in her van for a year now.
Looks pretty nice. It doesn't seem that you live here, but you do. I have seen people with their cars so messy and things all over the place. And how can I go to work with my life like that? I mean, has to have a little order, you know, because this is what we need to continue. It's not that perfect, but it's the way I want, and makes me feel better.
Just like Maria, around 30 other people sleep overnight in their car in this free parking lot. Nevertheless, most of them work. They're security guards, Uber drivers, secretaries, or even computer technicians. Maria is a cleaner and a carer, exhausting work that she does 7 days a week. To provide some comfort for all these people, an organization has supplied them with a water point, portable toilets, and a small outdoor kitchen where Maria prepares her morning coffee before going to work. Maria's fall from grace is a situation that affects thousands of other Americans. For a long time, she had everything she always wanted. She was married and lived in this beautiful house. But after 5 years of living together, her blissful marriage suddenly fell apart. This dream lifestyle was once an everyday reality for Eric. He was a successful computer engineer earning 7,000 euros a month. Today, at 53 years old, this man lives alone in his car. And to eat for free, he's made an agreement with the employees of a pizzeria.
Hello. How are you today?
Good, and you?
Good.
Here to pick up the
slices? Yep.
I got them for you.
Thank you.
What do you take here?
These are the slices that they have in their display that they have them for too long, then they put them in the fridge for me so that they donate them.
All right, here we go, two boxes.
Eric comes every evening to pick up some pizza.
Well, thank you very much. Very much appreciate it.
See you tomorrow.
Okay, bye-bye.
He's going to share these unsold slices with other victims of poverty, because for a year and a half, Eric has been sleeping in this parking lot, the one where Maria, the cleaner, also lives. With his pizza, he makes his neighbors very happy.
There's a lot.
Like Lorella, a 55-year-old Uber driver.
Looks good.
You hungry?
Yeah, we're hungry.
Did you eat today?
No.
No?
No, I had a drive all day today.
In his former life, Eric also worked a lot, 50 hours a week. But 4 years ago, he suffered a burnout, as well as a series of health problems, including problems with his heart. He could not work and received unemployment benefits for 6 months, and then nothing at all.
I thought I could handle it, I thought I would get better, but it took a toll, and after several years of just dealing with doctors and burning through my savings, I ended up basically burning through everything and couldn't afford to stay in an apartment any longer.
So this lady is named Teresa Smith. She has a PhD. And she created, broke through the San Diego issues and created a parking community. She rented a place, fenced it, put in porta potties, got the outdoor kitchen, got a security guard. I asked her how much did that cost. Now, I don't know if this video will come out, but if it does, that'll be nice. If not, we'll resume.
Well, Dreams for Change provides safe overnight parking for folks living out of their cars. They run sites in Chula Vista and Grant Hill. The program was especially helpful during our recent rains.
The rain brings some very specific problems to those in our vehicle. It's, you know, if they get wet when they go back into their vehicle to stay at night, that moisture, their seats, you know, there's no way to really get dry. They don't have a place to go get dry.
I can rest and I don't have to keep driving from place to place, because a lot of times what you'll find is people will try to harass you. And if you're out on the street and they see you're sleeping in your vehicle, bad things could happen. So I feel a lot safer here.
Dreams for Change also provides social workers at the parking lots to help the homeless find ways to get off the street. But it's not been welcome in every community. Another safe parking site was shut down a few months ago by Vista City Council, sending people to find other places for shelter, like the truck stop on Interstate 5.
When I was at the safe parking lot, I really had support of the social workers and people around me to make me feel safe and to help me get out of home being homeless. People at this parking lot, parking here tonight, don't have that same luxury. They don't have that support. They don't have the.
So I asked Teresa, how much did it cost? And she sent me her entire budget, okay? And it comes out to $25,000 per vehicle per year. Insurance, fencing, security guards, porta potties, garbage services, and locating it away from angry neighbors. So there's a little skill involved in doing this. But I used that figure of hers, and I said, well, what if you could do it nationally at that level? How much would it cost to create 65,000 safe parking places? $1.6 billion. I said we would do four things for these 260,000 people. Rental vouchers, homeless communities, parking lot communities. What's the fourth? The fourth is, by the way, that's how much each of those things cost. The fourth is creating RV parking communities. Now, that's for another 65,000 folks. How much is that going to cost? Well, about 16,000 Californians live in their RVs, okay? And if you say, well, most homeless people, by the way, they live in California. If we multiplied that by four, about 64,000 people. But a lot of these RVs are dilapidated. They're abandoned. They're eyesores. They have leaky roofs. They have to be towed away. So we're making the assumption that we're going to purchase for lease 35,000 RVs. Okay? I went shopping. I said, what about that? That's nice. That's nice. It looks good, but there's no toilet. It's going to be on a city street. It's still not adequate. And I thought, just think, what if you had an RV that had the following? It had a toilet, it had a shower, it had a tiny kitchen, it had a refrigerator, and you could drive it to work. That would be a pretty close approximation of an apartment. This actually is that you could drive that to Burger King and have a job and drive home, only you need a place to park. All right. So you could go from this to this. And I went shopping and I found one. That one cost $50,000. Another one cost $43,000. This one has an inside table. It's got a little kitchenette. It's got a refrigerator. It's got a convection or microwave oven.
Insulation.
This is an Italian. This is another European model. This one has, again, a kitchen, a refrigerator, a toilet, a wash base. Now, you're not going to go out and purchase 35,000 of these, but don't forget Trump's ventilators, okay? The Defense Production Act would allow the president to say, we need 35,000 mini RVs for our homeless population. And they have to be contracted out with Hyundai, this person, this company, and that company, and built. All right? Now, the next problem is parking. This is a major problem. Where do these vehicles go? Because they're eyesores, people don't like them. City councils say, get out of here. Remember this lady who lost her legs? Well, a few months after that video was made, they towed away her RV. All right? This woman had COVID or pneumonia, went to the hospital, came back, her RV was gone.
I was sicker than a dog before I went. I called the ambulance. They wouldn't take me in. I made my in-law take me 2 days later because I felt like I was dying, literally dying. And I had pneumonia caused from all of the freaking trying to clean this stuff up to get out of here fast enough. That made me sick.
Well, Teresa actually solved that problem too. She started an RV community, all right, where you could park your RV. You don't need to have a porta potty. You don't need to have outdoor kitchens. You just need security. And you need a place which is not going to anger the rest of the community. So I looked at her video. I calculated it comes out to about $1,800 per RV per year for that safe parking facility. But then I went to Mountain View where I live. I live in Silicon Valley. Average house here, I think, costs $1 million. So rents are exorbitant. And there I found a safe RV parking community. So I'm in a safe recreational vehicle parking lot. You see those porta potties there? Garbage. And these are recreational vehicles where people park. And it gives them an opportunity to live. So I asked the city of Mountain View, how much does it cost you? And they said $9,490 a year per vehicle. But they said, remember, it's not just one person. There are two or three people per RV. I said, well, okay. So I took their estimate of how much it costs and Teresa's of $1,800, and I put them together. So I think for $5,645 per vehicle per year, you could find and create safe RV parking communities, okay? So let's take a look at the cost. We're going to buy 35,000 RVs. We're going to assume that we can find parking facilities for them create those parking facilities. They're going to get a $75 cash allowance to maintain themselves. That's $61,000 per vehicle. That's $2.1 billion. But there are other 30,000 other RV users, and that getting them parking and a $75 a week allowance is another $280 million. So how much is this going to cost to create an RV community? $2.3 billion. Now, I'm going to throw a lot of numbers at you, but stay with me because this is where it actually gets exciting. We have four things we're going to do with these people. There it is, and here's the grand total. $10 billion to safely house 260,000 homeless, poor people who are not mentally ill and not drug addicts. Okay, what about the second year? How much is that going to cost? Let's assume that 15% get jobs and leave this program, but we still have the remainder. How much is that going to cost? $6 billion. So what's the total cost for rescuing 260,000 homeless people over 2 years? $16.7 billion. Okay, thank you for watching all those numbers go by, flying by. Now, no size fits all. So some people get rental vouchers, and some get homeless communities, some get live in their cars, some live in their RVs. But none of them are on the street. 260,000 people are not living on the street. Now, here's my third digression. Okay. You say to yourself, these people don't deserve this. I don't want to help criminals and drug addicts and bums. I don't believe we can afford this. And all of those thoughts are running through your head as you're listening to this proposal, really. But let's remember one important thing. We are the richest nation in the world with the highest GDP, and it is absolutely abominable that we allow 500,000 people to sleep out in the streets, in the cold, in the rain, and freeze their feet off and have to have them amputated. It is inhumane. And we started this by saying, our country is better than that. We have to stop this. This is an emergency. We are going to stop it. And that takes precedence over all these other thoughts that you have. This is shameful and unacceptable for our country. Okay? That's my third and last digression. Now, we have to make this work. We need other people. A social worker earns $57,000 a year. Okay? And let's imagine that a social worker worked with four people a day. She helped this person who is mentally ill find placement in a psychiatric facility. Helped this person who's a drug addict get into a 90-day residential rehab facility. Helped this person find rental housing. Helped this person get a place for their RV where they can safely live. Four people a day, 20 people a week, 80 people a month. So what if we said all the 580,000 people who are homeless see a social worker at least once a month? How many social workers do you need? You need 7,250 social workers. They would see every one of our homeless people at least once a month to help them, to provide support, to get them on food stamps, to get them in Medicare, out of Medicare, into Section 8 housing, whatever. Okay? That's $435 million a year. We also have to think about a brain trust. This program would be operated through the federal government, through the Housing and Urban Development, through Homeland Security, through Health and Human Services. But we need smart people who have done this. This guy started two homeless communities. He knows what he's talking about. That guy created the biggest homeless gated community in the United States with an outdoor theater. We need these people as part of the brain trust. Teresa has solved the problem of parking. Okay, these are people who've been there and done that. This lady knows about mentally ill people and placing them in psychiatric hospitals. So we need a brain trust of 20 people at $150,000 each to guide and shepherd this program into existence. That's $3 million a year. All right. Now, this is the surprise. This is where your mind is going to be blown. Okay, so if you have stayed with me with all these numbers, you're going to say, oh my God, I can't believe this. We can do this. Watch. The total end To end homelessness in 2 years, residential care for the mentally ill, $15 billion. Residential drug treatment, and then post-drug treatment rentals, $12 billion. 260,000 homeless people off the street, $10 billion. Social workers and other personnel, $438 million. Grand total for the first year, $37 billion. What about the second year? The second year totals $17 billion. What about solving homelessness completely in this country in 2 years? How much? $55.42 billion. To solve homelessness, no more homelessness. My daughter is a singer-songwriter. I'm sorry, this is the fourth digression. She goes to she appears in this big theater in San Francisco with a comedian, another comedian. The comedian walks into the theater and steps in human excrement. Okay, that's San Francisco. That's over. It's over and done with. No more tents, no more people sleeping under bridges, no more mentally ill people wandering into Starbucks. Okay, it's over. $55 billion. Now, here's where your mind is going to be blown. Read carefully. After delay, the U.S. Senate edges towards passing $55 billion Ukraine war aid. Oh, they actually passed it, 81 to 11. Rand Paul said, wait a minute, who's getting this money? Oh, who's going to pay for all of this? And they said, shut up, Rand. And they passed it, 81 to 11, overwhelmingly appropriated, not in 2 years, in 1 year. We're talking about 2 years to solve homelessness in the United States. Now, I know in your mind you say, well, they did that, but somewhere in your mind you know this comes out of your pocket. These are tax dollars. So the average taxpayer paid or is going to pay $454 to help Ukraine defeat Russia? We're going to defeat the world's largest nuclear superpower with our weapons, our howitzers and our drones and all that $55 billion worth of armor that we're sending over there. Really? Do you believe that? You believe a year from now that $55 billion will have resulted in Russia hightailing it out of the Ukraine because of our support? Well, let's, for the same amount of money, $227 this year and $227 next year, we would end homelessness in this country completely. Okay, so let's vote. Do you really want to spend $55 billion to have the Ukraine defeat Russia? We're in it for the long haul. Do you believe in that? I mean, do you think a year from now that's going to come true? Would you pay this amount of money to end homelessness in the United States in 2 years? So remember, this $55 billion does not go to the Ukraine. It goes to weapons manufacturers in the United States, Lockheed Martin, Boeing, Northrop Grumman, Raytheon. They're the ones who get the money. Okay, and then they send the howitzers and the drones and the Harpoon missiles to the Ukraine. This guy was a lobbyist who asked for the Pentagon to give them money. And later on, he became the Secretary of Defense. Mark Esper was a lobbyist for Raytheon, and he became the Secretary of Defense. They're like that. There are people who appear on television who say, we've got to help the Ukraine. Read the blue. Yet they fail to mention these pundits' ties to defense contractors and their financial interest in pushing U.S. military intervention. This guy was the director of the Defense Intelligence Agency for the Pentagon. He resigned and worked for the defense contractors who want money from the Pentagon. This lady was undersecretary for acquisition for the Pentagon. She bought things for the Pentagon, She resigned, and now she sells things to the Pentagon. Okay, this is a guy named Daniel Vladich who has an almost $1 billion contract with Ukraine's oil and gas lobby. So these are well-connected lobbyists. They grab the $55 billion, and they have tremendous amount of influence over the Senate and the Congress. They grab the money and run. Oops, sorry. Since I started this just 2 weeks ago, we're giving the Ukraine another billion. So make that $56 billion, okay? But these people do not have any lobbyists in Washington who are well-connected, wearing suits and ties and saying, give us more money, give us more money, give us more money. They don't have anybody representing them. And they need $55 billion to put an end to this suffering. And it would put an end to this suffering.
What are you doing out here in the rain?
I got to let it go.
Hey, Savage, give him your umbrella. He's sitting on the cold. Here you go, brother. Enjoy. Don't cry. It's okay. Don't cry.
Well, I'm their lobbyist, and if you stayed with me through this presentation and you got to this point, you're probably their lobbyist too. So we need to have our voices heard, and we need to find the compassion and do this. It's all. If there's anything you walk away with this from this video, it is that we can do this. It's within the realm of possibility to just stop this. It can be stopped. So I want to remind you that we had 580,000 homeless people. Well, there are 579,999 because during this talk, one homeless person died. One homeless person dies one every hour and 10 minutes in this country. Okay? So let's keep them in our hearts and in our minds. And I wrote this book. It's got a lot of the references in it. You can get it on Amazon. If you want to get in touch with me, you can get through my website. If you go to the description, it's got some more references. All of these facts that I gave you, are the documentation is there. So thank you for watching, and spread the word, okay? Thank you.